Pentecostals get their name from the biblical day of Pentecost, in which God first poured out his Holy Spirit on about 120 disciples on the day of Pentecost, as recorded in Acts chapter 2. Pentecostals believe that the same gift of the Holy Spirit with speaking in unknown tongues as the Spirit gives utterance, which was first received at the inauguration of the New Testament church on Pentecost, is still promised for all true believers in the last days, even until the second coming of Jesus Christ. The day of Pentecost was the birth of the New Testament church. It was not without significance that God made the disciples wait until the day of Pentecost to receive the full new birth experience of the water and of the Spirit, according to the words of Jesus in John 3:5. Pentecost literally means 50. It simply means 50. The number 50 is used in Scripture to symbolically represent liberty, as in the year of Jubilee. Every 50th year, slaves were liberated, debts were canceled, and liberty was proclaimed throughout the land. Paul wrote, "Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty," in 2 Corinthians 3:17. Moreover, it was at Pentecost that Israel first received the law of God at Mount Sinai, just 50 days after departing from Egypt at Passover. In like manner, the New Testament disciples received the Holy Spirit at Pentecost to write his laws in their hearts just 50 days after Passover, 50 days after Christ's death. Hence, the law was given on the Old Covenant day of Pentecost as a type of what was to come when the law would be given spiritually on the New Covenant day of Pentecost, the law of liberty as opposed to the law of bondage. Now the law of God is written on the fleshly tables of our hearts through the Holy Spirit of God. But before, the law was external in the Old Testament time period. Great and marvelous is the wisdom of God, who masterminded so great a salvation for his people. Jeremiah 31:33 says, "But this shall be the covenant that I will make in the future, says the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts." End quote. Again, Ezekiel 36:26 and 27 says, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes." End quote. So here we find that God says he would put his law in our inward parts and write his law in our hearts through the prophet Jeremiah. And again, God spoke through Ezekiel saying, "I will put my spirit within you and will cause you to walk in my statutes," because God would write his laws in our hearts through the Holy Spirit of God given unto his people. The Jews have always referred to the day of Pentecost as the feast of the giving of the law, or the birthday of Judaism. Likewise, the day of Pentecost speaks to the New Testament believers as the first day of the proclamation of the law of liberty and the birthday of the New Testament church. So when we think about it, just like God first birthed his law during the Old Testament law under Moses, God also birthed his law of liberty by pouring out his Spirit on the day of Pentecost as the birthday of the New Covenant church. So in the Old Testament, the law was written externally, but now in the New Testament, God's law is written internally on our hearts by the Spirit of God abiding in us. Pentecost was known as the Feast of the Harvest. It was literally the Feast of the Wheat Harvest. Spiritually speaking, Pentecost denotes a time of celebration and great joy for God's people because of the great harvest of the souls of mankind which would be born into the New Testament church. The scriptures speak of receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit with the initial sign of tongues as a necessity. The prophet Isaiah spoke of the promise of the Holy Spirit when he prophesied in Isaiah 28, 9-12, "Whom shall he teach knowledge? And to whom will he make to understand the message? Those just weaned from the milk, those just drawn from the breasts. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people, to whom he said, this is the rest wherewith you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. Yet they would not hear. Here we find that the prophet Isaiah prophesied that for God's people to truly find the knowledge of God, to understand the message of God, is for his people to search the scriptures precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, and there a little. In other words, we've got to search the whole Bible, all of the scriptural data, a little bit here, a little bit there, one scripture here, one scripture there. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. In other words, another language, different languages that we don't know. For just like a baby who first learns how to speak a new language, sometimes the child stumbles, a child stammers. So likewise, when people speak in tongues, they often, when they first begin, especially when they first start speaking in tongues, they tend to speak with stammering or stumbling lips, and they don't speak it maybe exactly as fluent. I found this to be true. You know, as you pray in tongues more often, you get more fluent, but when you're not used to it, you tend to stammer, you tend to stumble a little bit when you speak in tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. But the scripture says, with stammering lips, another tongue will he speak to this people, to whom he said, this is the rest with which you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. Now, Peter cited the prophet Joel when he said, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and they shall prophesy. When one speaks under the inspiration of the Spirit by speaking in unknown tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance, he or she is speaking under the inspiration. The Greek word prophetēo literally means speaking under the inspiration. It can mean forthtelling or foretelling. It doesn't necessarily mean a predicted prophecy. It can mean just speaking under the inspiration. So when we speak in tongues as the Spirit gives us the ability, the utterance to speak in unknown languages, we are speaking as the Spirit gives the utterance, which is a form of prophecy. So when Joel wrote, it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, he was talking about the day of Pentecost. With stammering lips and an unknown tongue will he speak to this people. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. Yet they would not hear. The Jews would not hear the message, or the vast majority of the Jews would not obey the message. So the true message of God is understood by the Hebrew prophets. A little bit here, a little bit there. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. This is the rest. Peter cited Joel saying, this is that. This is the rest, which was spoken by the prophet Joel and was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. This is the rest wherewith you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. We find a marvelous correlation of Scripture when we compare the words of the prophet Isaiah's prophecy with Jesus' own words in Matthew 11, 28, 29. Jesus is the one who causes the weary to rest through the supernatural experience of speaking in stammering lips and another tongue. Jesus said in Matthew 11, 28, 29, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Notice, the weary to rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. End quote. The rest and refreshing of God speaking to his people with stammering lips and an unknown tongue is consistent with Jesus' own description of the birth of the Spirit according to John 3, 5-8. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. John 3, 5-8. Here Jesus Christ describes what happens with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Because the wind, spirit, or breath of God blows where it wishes, and you hear that wind, spirit, breath of God. You hear the sound of that spirit, wind or breath of God speaking. Now, how do we hear the sound, breath, or spirit of God speaking? The original Greek word translated as wind is pneuma. The word pneuma literally means spirit, wind, or breath. In every other place that I could find in the Greek New Testament where the word pneuma is used throughout New Testament scripture, it is always translated into English as the word spirit, never wind, except in this one instance. Hence, the more literal and consistent Greek rendering of this passage in John chapter 3, verse 8, 5 to 8, the consistent rendering of this passage in the emphatic dialogue renders John 3, 8 as the Spirit breathes, not the wind, but the Spirit of God breathes, where it, the Spirit of God, will, and you hear its voice. You hear the Spirit's voice. Thus it is with everyone who has been born of the Spirit. So everyone who is born again of the Spirit, there will be a hearing of the Spirit's voice. And so we can't say that a sinner's prayer is hearing the Spirit's voice. We're talking about God speaking through his people. To come to pass in the last days, saith God, I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. All of God's people will prophesy, because when everyone speaks in tongues, we are prophesying, because we're speaking under the inspiration, because God's speaking through us in unknown languages, as the Spirit gives us the utterance, according to Acts 2:4. It's the Spirit speaking through us, giving us the words to say, but our mind is not focused on these words. It's the Spirit giving us these words in a supernatural manner. The J.P. Green Interlinear Bible, which is consistent with most other literal word-for-word interlinears, also renders John 3:8 as follows. The Spirit, not the wind, the Spirit breathes where he desires, and you hear his voice, the Spirit's voice, but you do not know where he comes from, where the Spirit comes from, and where he, the Spirit, goes. So is everyone who has received birth from the Spirit. End quote. And we find the Spirit breathes where the Spirit of God desires, and you hear the Spirit of God's voice. You hear it. So is everyone who has received birth from the Spirit. What is Jesus talking about when he said that the Spirit breathes and you hear its voice, or his voice? Surely he is not talking about a believer making a verbal confession of faith. This cannot be said to be the Spirit's voice. There is something else that Jesus is referring to in which everyone must receive to receive the new birth of the Spirit. The only supernatural phenomenon found in the Bible in which God's Spirit blows or breathes upon his people and you hear the Spirit's sound or voice is speaking in unknown tongues or languages as the Spirit gives the utterance. Acts 2, 1-4 says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. The Spirit of God came down, and it was a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues or other languages as the Spirit gave them utterance. They didn't speak in other languages as pertaining to their own ability. They didn't speak in other languages because they were taught other languages. They spoke in other languages or other unknown tongues as the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, gave them the utterance or the ability to speak those words. On the day of Pentecost, the early believers in Jesus heard the sound of a rushing mighty wind, which was obviously a supernatural sign that the Spirit of God was anthropomorphically breathing his Spirit presence down upon his followers. Then the next verse says, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Here we find the Spirit of God breathes or blows his divine presence down on his followers, and the Spirit's voice was heard on the day of Pentecost when the believers began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the ability. Since it was the Spirit who gave them the utterance, we know it was the indwelling Holy Spirit of God speaking through the disciples. Thus, we can clearly link the voice of the Spirit being heard when New Testament believers receive the new birth of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Again, John 3:8 says in the emphatic Greek diagla, the Spirit breathes where it will, and you hear its voice. Thus it is with everyone who has been born of the Spirit. And again, the J.P. Green Interlinear Bible says, John 3:8, the Spirit breathes where he desires, and you hear his voice. Whose voice is the context in John 3:8? It's the Spirit's voice. But you do not know from where he, the Spirit, comes from, where he goes, because God's Spirit is invisible. So is everyone who has received birth from the Spirit, because you hear the Spirit's voice. It is hard to imagine that the repetition of a sinner's prayer or saying a mere verbal confession of faith is the Spirit's voice. The only evidence we have in New Testament Scripture where we hear the sound of the Spirit's voice is when the New Testament believers first received the gift of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:4. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in unknown tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance or gave them the words to speak. Jesus stated in Mark 16:17 that one of the signs that shall follow them that truly believe upon Jesus Christ, as the Scriptures have said, would be that they will speak with new tongues. Jesus said in Mark 16:17, these signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. In Acts chapter 10, we read of an unsaved Roman centurion. A centurion was a leader of 100 Roman soldiers. His name was Cornelius. He was a devout man who feared God according to the law of Moses. While in prayer one day, he saw an angel in a vision who said to him, your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Now send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He will tell you what you must do. You know, all of the good works, praying to God always, giving alms and doing good deeds, that's not going to save you. But there was something that Cornelius needed to do beside praying to God and giving alms to the people. There's something he had to do to get right with God to be saved. Acts 11:14 says, Peter later testified to his Jewish brothers that the angel further said to Cornelius that the apostle Peter shall tell you words whereby you and all your household shall be saved. So here we know that in Acts 10:4 through 6, it wasn't just something that Cornelius needed to do. He will tell you what you must do. Peter would tell Cornelius and his household what he must do, whereby he and all of his household shall be saved. So if we will follow the words of inspired Scripture, in which the Apostle Peter gave word for word verbatim instructions how Cornelius and his household were to be saved, then we will also experience the self-same gospel salvation of the first century New Testament church. Cornelius and those who were with him obeyed the angel's instructions and sent for Simon Peter, who preached salvation through believing in the name of Jesus Christ. Acts 10:43 through 47 gives us the following account of the conversion of Cornelius, his household, and his cohorts. In fact, the Scripture says that it wasn't just Cornelius and his family, but his friends and his relatives. Now, bear in mind, Cornelius was a Roman centurion. He had a lot of influence. He was a leader of 100 Roman soldiers. So he had his family with him. He had his relatives with him. He had Italian soldiers, friends of his that were soldiers with him. And the Scripture says that these were all Gentiles and not Jews that received the Spirit in Acts chapter 10. So here's the account in Acts 10, 43 through 47. Peter's preaching. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, the name of Jesus Christ, whosoever believes in him will receive remission of sins. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit of God fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision, obviously the Jews, who believed, were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, the non-Jews. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then Peter answered, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So here Peter obviously was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, that all men must have faith in Jesus Christ to receive the remission of sins. And then God poured out his Spirit. Notice the scripture says the gift of the Holy Spirit. There's a lot of Pentecostals who try to say, well, the gift of the Holy Spirit is one experience and the baptism of the Holy Spirit is another experience. No, not according to New Testament scripture. I'm sorry. You know, a lot of people like to water down the Word of God or maybe candy coat it to try to please people. But no, the scripture is very clear. The gift of the Holy Spirit is the baptism of the Holy Spirit that was poured out on the Gentiles for they heard them speak with tongues. So here we find that we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit by speaking in unknown tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance, just like on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. We don't have a different salvation experience that Cornelius and his household and relatives received and friends received in Acts chapter 10, and from the experience that the Jews received on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. It's the self-same New Testament gospel salvation, first preached on the day of Pentecost, then to the Samaritans, and then to the Gentiles in Acts chapter 10. We find that the Jews knew that the Roman Gentiles had received the gift of the Holy Spirit, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. In the conversion account of the Roman Gentiles, there is nothing to justify a belief in a new birth of the Spirit prior to receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. How then did the believing Jews, which came with Peter, know that the Gentiles had received the gift of the Holy Spirit? The only scriptural answer, which is consistent with Jesus' own words, the Spirit breathes where he will or it will, and you hear the Spirit's voice. Thus it is with everyone who has been born of the Spirit, is hearing them speak with tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Hence, there can be no doubt that the believing Jews were convinced that the Gentiles had received the Holy Spirit when they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. True Bible-believing Christians should have the same faith in the words of Jesus and the words of the apostles to receive the same gift as he gave to the early Jewish and Gentile converts when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you received the Holy Spirit since or when you believed? In Acts chapter 19, Paul said, no, they didn't receive, because believing in Jesus does not automatically convey the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is something that you must receive from God, and just a mere profession of faith or just saying you believe is not enough. You must receive the gift of the Holy Spirit just like they did in the New Testament church. Those who say that a verbal confession alone automatically causes one to receive the Holy Ghost must ask why the Bible is silent about such a belief. The scriptures say that a believer is to repent and be baptized, and he shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. When we compare Acts 2:38 with Acts 8:12-16, we find that the believing Samaritans were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, but did not receive the Holy Spirit until after Peter and John came down from Jerusalem. Let us cite Acts chapter 8, verses 15-17, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost or Holy Spirit. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. So notice, Peter and John prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. In other words, these people were already believers. They had already repented of their sins and were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. They took all that time to get everybody baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus in Samaria. And yet Peter and John prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost is just archaic for Holy Spirit. So the gift of the Holy Spirit is not automatically received upon a verbal confession of faith or a sinner's prayer of repentance. Because if that were the case, the scripture always says repent and be baptized. We know that the believing Samaritans believed, repented of their sins, and were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yet the Holy Spirit had not yet fallen upon them because they prayed for them they might receive the Holy Ghost. Inspired scriptures do not say that the moment one believes that he automatically receives the Holy Spirit. That's a lie from the pit of hell. I'm sorry, that's false doctrine. I don't care how much you respect people, how many tens of thousands of millions of people believe this. Paul says, though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have you not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Let's go back to the apostles and let them be our fathers. Let's not listen to all these pastors and priests and people today. I don't care what 10,000 instructors of Christ might say. Let's hear what the apostle Peter, who had the keys to the kingdom of heaven, had said about receiving the Holy Ghost. Let us hear what Paul, who also was a foundational apostle of Jesus Christ, let us hear what they have to say. And let us not listen to the lies of men's tradition. In order to try to please men, we try to compromise the gospel to try to win more converts. But let's focus on what the scriptures say rather than what the opinions of men have said. So the scripture is clear that receiving the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit of God, is not something that automatically comes just by a mere verbal confession or a sinner's prayer of repentance. Inspired scripture does not say that the moment one believes, he automatically receives the Spirit. The scriptures plainly declare that all who would lawfully enter into God's kingdom must believe, repent, and be baptized, of course, in the name of Jesus Christ, and they shall receive the Holy Spirit, or the gift of the Holy Spirit. This is consistent with Jesus' own words found in Luke chapter 11, verses 5 to 13. And he said to them, which of you shall have a friend, and go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. And I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. Then Jesus goes on to say, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Notice the context of Jesus' own words about a friend going to another friend at midnight asking for 3 loaves. And though the friend, a neighbor, is very neighborly and friendly, that neighbor is going to be kind of upset. Hey, it's midnight. I might have the 3 loaves, but don't bother me. Or the neighbor keeps knocking and keeps persisting. Well, that other neighbor is just going to say, okay, just take the 3 loaves. Don't bother me. Of course, I don't know how much that neighbor's going to stay so friendly. But bottom line, though, he'll get those 3 loaves more than likely as long as he's persistent and they have the 3 loaves to give. So Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. He said, knock and it will be opened to you. And now he's talking about persistence in prayer. Then he goes on to say, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Here we find sometimes you got to be a little persistent in believing God for the promise. And so the Holy Spirit could not automatically be given upon a mere confession of faith or a repeat after me repentance prayer, which is not a biblical thing. Repentance needs to be spoken from the heart, but to say repeat after me is a repentance, that's not a biblical way to repent. When one repents of his sins, he or she must repent from inwardly in his or her heart. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a beautiful verbal prayer. It could just be crying from the heart and just saying, God, save me. I turn from my sin. That's it. It doesn't have to be a long, beautiful prayer. It just has to be a decision from the heart to repent and turn. The word repent means to turn from one's selfish and sinful way of living. After faith in Jesus Christ as one's personal Savior and repenting from his inward heart, with a true heartfelt repentance of turning from his or her sins, then one shall ask for the Holy Spirit, and God says he will give the Holy Spirit to him. Of course, you must first repent and believe the gospel before you can receive the Holy Spirit. The context of Luke chapter 11 indicates that a confession of Jesus Christ as Lord or a repentance does not automatically impart the Holy Spirit. Jesus' instructions clearly state that persistence in asking God their Father for the gift of the Holy Spirit is sometimes necessary, which implies that receiving the gift of the Spirit does not automatically come in a prayer of repentance. The Apostle Paul's teachings also confirm that receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit is not automatically imparted upon faith or repentance, because our faith in Jesus Christ is demonstrated when we believe and are baptized into his name. Mark 16:16, Jesus said, "He that believes and is baptized shall be saved." So baptism is also important, a necessary part of the remission of sins through faith in the name of Christ. That's why we're baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, because we are showing our faith in Jesus Christ as our Lord and personal Savior when we get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. It is through faith that we receive the remission of sins through His name, through the name of Jesus Christ. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved other than the name of Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 19, 1 through 6 says, "Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus, and finding some disciples," notice he used the word disciples, which means that these believers were disciplined after the teachings of Christ. "He said to them, 'Did you receive the Holy Spirit since you believed?'" Obviously, they believed in Jesus Christ already. But Paul said, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit since you believe?" Since you believe in Jesus, your Messiah. So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." In other words, we haven't so much as heard if the Holy Spirit has been given yet. Obviously, John the Baptist, these were disciples of John the Baptist. And so John had preached that the one will come after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to untie. He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Well, they hadn't heard about the Holy Spirit being given yet. And so Paul said to them, "Into what then were you baptized?" Notice, he connects baptism with receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. So they said, "Into John's baptism," John the Baptist's baptism. Then Paul had said, "John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized again, this time in the name of the Lord Jesus." They were baptized before in John's baptism, but John had said they were to believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Notice the connection to believing upon the one who would come after John, that is Jesus Christ, and baptism into his name. See, we show our faith in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior by believing upon him through being baptized into his name. This is very clear in Acts chapter 19, 1 through 6. So when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Notice, here we find again another example where this time the Apostle Paul laid his hands on them, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance, just like the Jews did on the day of Pentecost, just like the Gentiles did in Acts chapter 10. According to Acts 19, there can be no doubt that it is possible to believe in Jesus without receiving the Holy Spirit. How many people out there today in 21st century America think they have the Holy Spirit and they don't have it? They think they have the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit doesn't come just by a verbal confession of faith or repeat after me prayer, which is not even a scriptural thing to do. Truly, we must repent of our sins, but even repentance does not automatically involve receiving the Holy Spirit. You know, even Saul of Tarsus, I'm thinking, I don't have this in my notes here, but Saul of Tarsus believed in Jesus when he was persecuting Christians on his way to Damascus. And the Messiah, Jesus, appeared as a great light. And he fell down, and from the great light, he was blinded. He said, "Who are you, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus, whom you're persecuting." And then Saul of Tarsus said, "What shall I do, Lord? What must I do, Lord, to get right with you?" "Go into the city of Damascus, and it will be told what you must do." He repented of his sins right then and there. We find later on that Ananias comes to him and said, "The Lord Jesus, whom you met on the way, has sent me to you, that you might receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." So Saul of Tarsus didn't receive the Holy Spirit until Ananias prayed for him to receive the Holy Spirit. And then Ananias said, "And now why do you tarry, Saul? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." Again, the sins of Saul of Tarsus was not legally washed away by his repentance. We know he believed in Jesus because he went which way the Lord told him to go. He was waiting in the city of Damascus, praying and fasting 3 days, 3 nights, no food or water, waiting to be told what he must do. And so he repented of his sins, but still He had to arise and be baptized in order to wash away his sins, calling on the name of Jesus Christ in baptism. This is so plain. I don't know why people don't see it. You know, the scripture says, if our gospel be hid, it's hid to those that are lost, in whom the God of this age has blinded the minds of those that do not believe, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine to them. Beloved, I feel the power and presence of God here. This is the true gospel message. Why are so many millions and millions of professing Christians deceived by the devil? I don't know why. People are so foolish. We are like just so foolish. People are so foolish. Beloved, we need to stop listening to the traditions of men, the rudiments of the world, and all these so-called gospel preachers. I don't care how much you want to respect gospel preachers out there. But beloved, let's obey the word of God. Let's obey what God's word says. Shall we obey God or men? You be the judge. Hallelujah. According to Acts chapter 19, there can be no doubt that it is possible to believe in Jesus and to repent of one's sins without receiving the Holy Spirit. The Ephesians, who were John the Baptist's disciples, had believed upon Christ to such an extent that they disciplined their lives according to the knowledge that they had heard about Christ from John the Baptist. John the Baptist preached repentance to the people. So these Ephesian believers were disciples because they had repented of their sins and believed in the coming Messiah, but they had not yet received the Holy Spirit. The scriptures would not have called the Ephesian believers disciples if they had not repented and adhered to the discipleship teachings of John the Baptist about Christ. Wherefore, they must have repented of their sins prior to getting baptized into John's baptism. Paul addressed two things that the Ephesian disciples needed for salvation. Paul addressed water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ and receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit, Spirit baptism. We must understand that the book of Acts is the only New Testament book which gives us an actual historical account of people actually getting saved word for word verbatim under the apostolic teaching and preaching. Just as in the four Gospels, each account in the book of Acts does not always explain every single detail of each historical event. Therefore, we must carefully examine each conversion account in the book of Acts and compare them together to find out what we must do to receive full New Testament salvation. Acts chapter 8 does not directly state that the Samaritan spoke in tongues. However, the context demands it. And I quote Acts 8, 14 through 18. Now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God. Notice, they received the word of God. They heard the gospel message. They received the gospel message. They believed in Jesus Christ as their Savior. They repented of their sins. They sent Peter and John to them, who when they had come down, prayed for them that they might. Notice, that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. That had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So notice here, the Samaritans believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ. They repented of their sins. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Notice, the words only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus proves there was something else that the Samaritans needed to receive beside water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money. Simon would not have offered to give the apostles money to be able to repeat a prayer for the Samaritans to receive the Holy Ghost. Obviously, there was a supernatural sign that was so impressive to Simon, they said, let me give you money here because I want to lay hands on people and have them speak in unknown tongues too. It's very clear the context demands that in Acts chapter 8 that these Samaritans were receiving the Holy Spirit with the initial sign of tongues. And so again, look at the context of Acts chapter 8 that the apostles Peter and John came up from Jerusalem. They came down to Samaria and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Now we find in the next verse that they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So they received the gospel message. They believed in Jesus Christ as their Savior, repented of their sins, were baptized into his name. Yet they had only been baptized. Notice, only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. There was something missing. Jesus said, you must be born of the water and of the Spirit. They were not born of the Spirit. Then they laid their hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. very clear that here again, the gift of the Holy Spirit had not yet been given, had not yet been poured out at the time of faith and repentance and Christian baptism. So again, the people of Samaria had received the word of God, were baptized in water, but the Holy Spirit had not yet fallen upon them. The context of Acts 8, 14 through 18 proves that there was a definite evidence proving that the Samaritans had received the Spirit, just as there was a definitive evidence in other conversion accounts throughout the book of Acts. Philip the evangelist could have easily said, "Repeat the following words of a confession of faith," and then told the Samaritans that they had received the Holy Spirit. Isn't that what people are doing today? Everybody just bow your head in prayer and repeat these words and thank God you're all saved, you all got the Holy Spirit. That's not what they did. It's nowhere to be found in the Bible, the sinner's prayer of a verbal confession of faith and repentance. It's just not there. There is no wording in Scripture to give rise to the belief that one has received the Holy Spirit without the initial sign of speaking in tongues. Again, Simon the sorcerer would not have desired the power to repeat a prayer if verbal confession alone brought the power to receive the Holy Spirit. Again, John 3:8 says, J.P. Green, Interlinear Bible, "The Spirit breathes where He, the Spirit of God, desires, and you hear His voice." The context proves the Spirit of God's voice. So is everyone who has received birth from the Spirit. Everyone who is truly born of the Spirit will have the Spirit of God breathe or blow His divine presence upon them, and they will hear His voice, the Spirit's voice, when they speak in unknown tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance, just as the first New Testament believers did on the day of Pentecost, which was the official birth of the New Testament church. We are not suggesting that we are not to be saved by grace through faith. Faith and grace are vital to salvation. But to teach that belief alone as whole salvation is not scripturally founded. James said in his epistle, "You believe that there is one God." That's fine. Even the demons believe that there's one God and tremble with fear. There must be an initial faith response to the gospel. In Romans 10:16, the prophet Isaiah is cited as saying, "But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report?" So here we find a connection between believing in the report or believing in the message of the gospel and obeying the gospel. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. Again, in Acts 6:7, the scriptures say that a great company or number of the priests were obedient to the faith. Notice, obedient to the faith. Here we find the evidence that there must be an initial faith response to the gospel in which we obey the gospel. How do we obey the gospel? We repent of our sins and get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and we shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. True belief will lead one to believe upon Christ as the scriptures have said, in order to receive the rivers of living water that Jesus Christ promised. "He that believes upon me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." Genuine faith in Christ will move us to obey the whole gospel message of repentance and remission of sins through faith in His name. Therefore, true biblical faith leads to true repentance, true Christian baptism, and true Spirit baptism. Nowhere does the Bible give credence to the notion that belief or confession alone is whole Bible salvation. While the scriptures affirm that belief and confession are requirements that lead us to whole salvation, a mere profession of faith is not salvation in and of itself. Romans 10:9 and 10. "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved." You just believe in Jesus Christ right here and you're going to be saved. You will be saved. But notice the next verse. "For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." So confession alone is not Bible salvation, not whole Bible salvation, but confession with the mouth leads us unto salvation. Romans 10:10 does not say that confession is salvation in and of itself. It says that confession is made unto salvation. There is no disharmony between scriptures that speak of the necessity of belief, grace, and confession, and the scriptures that speak of the necessity of being born of the water and of the Spirit, according to John 3, 3-5. Hebrews 6, 1-2 says, the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, notice baptisms plurally, water and spirit, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 and 2 states that the church of Jesus Christ is built upon the foundational doctrine of baptisms, water and spirit. Hebrews 6, 1 and 2 lists faith toward God, repentance from dead works, belief in the resurrection, which are all necessary for salvation. If we don't believe in the resurrection, we're yet in our sins, Paul said. If we don't repent from our dead works, the Bible says, repent or shall all likewise perish. For no one can be saved without genuine faith toward God, which includes faith in Christ Jesus as Emmanuel, God with us in human existence. Repentance from our sins. We must repent or shall all likewise perish. And a genuine heartfelt belief in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hence, just as faith toward God, repentance, and faith in the resurrection are necessary for salvation, so also is the doctrine of baptisms, water and spirit baptism, also necessary. Hebrews chapter 6 does not state the doctrine of baptism in the singular. It says the doctrine of baptisms in the plural, which means that there is more than one type of baptism. The New Testament only speaks of two baptisms, one of water and one of the Spirit. Jesus said, unless one is born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Therefore, both are necessary for all true believers to receive. Do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel for weekly videos, or you can visit us on the web at apostolicchristianfaith.com. Lord bless you.